Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Let us stand together and join in the call to worship. The Lord is King. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He is girded with strength.
He has established
the world. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. More majestic than the thunders of mighty waters, more majestic than the waves of the sea, majestic on high is the Lord.
Your decrees are very sure.
Holiness befits your house,
O Lord.
Let us worship God. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal God, by raising Jesus from the dead, you proclaimed his victory, and by his ascension, you declared him Lord of all. Lift up our hearts to heaven, where he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God, who is always faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. In humility and faith, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have raised Jesus from death to life and crowned him Lord of all. We confess that we have not bowed before him or acknowledged his rule in our lives. We have gone along with the ways of the world and failed to give him glory. Forgive us and raise us from sin, that we may be your faithful people, obeying the commands of our Lord Jesus Christ, who rules the world and is head of the church, his body. Amen. Hear now the good news. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Friends, God has not left us without guidance for living. Indeed, God has given us the law as our teacher, for the Lord Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two laws hang all the law and the prophets." Friends, in Jesus Christ we have been reconciled to God. In Christ we have been reconciled to one another. Indeed, Christ has entrusted to us the ministry of reconciliation. Let us celebrate this ministry of reconciliation by passing the peace of Christ with one another. The peace of Christ be with you all.
Grace, mercy, and peace unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, on behalf of the officers of the congregation, the elders and deacons, I bid all who are worshiping here this morning a warm word of welcome. It is good to have this family of God together once again, both in this house of God and those joining us by webcast. However you are joining us this morning, welcome. We're glad you're here. If you're a visitor with us this morning, whether here or joining us by webcast, we extend to you the invitation to join us whenever you are here. If you're from out of town, visiting family or friends, or whatever brings you to Tyler, we extend to you the invitation to treat this as your own church whenever you find yourself in Tyler. On the other hand, if you live in or near Tyler and don't have a church home, or you happen to be looking for a new church home, we extend to you the invitation to join us in membership. We'd love to have you as part of this household of faith. If you'd like to learn more about how to become active and involved in the life of this church, if you'd like to learn how to become a member of this church, you may indicate that interest in the friendship pads as they're now being passed. Or there are little cards in the pew rack ahead of you. One says, welcome to FPC. You just find that, fill it out, and drop it in the offering plate later in the service. Or if you're joining us by webcast, go to our website, fpctyler.com, where you can learn a lot about the church. And if you have questions, email us, church@fpctyler.com. And we'd be glad to get back with you and answer whatever questions you might have about the life of this church. There are friendship pads, by the way, in each pew near the center aisle. If you haven't found it already, would you do that? Please fill it out, pass it to the end of the pew, and then back again, so that everyone has a chance to register his or her presence. It is a big help for us. And if you're a visitor and don't mind, we'd love to have not only your name, but your address, phone number, email. We simply would like to have the opportunity to contact you in the days ahead, just to let you know how glad we are that you're here with us today. So tomorrow is Memorial Day, comes around every year, as you know, and it is a time not like Veterans Day, where we remember our veterans. It is a day to remember those in our nation's history who have died in battle, in war. Although one of you reminded me earlier this morning that many, if not most of the people in uniform in our country who have died not of battle wounds, but of other kinds of things. Very often it was sheer infection. But whatever it is, this is a weekend, surely, when we can remember those who wore our uniforms and died in the protection and of our nation and its people. So tomorrow, in the midst of all of the other things that you're doing, whether barbecuing or whatever else it is, take a few moments and just remember those possibly in your own families who have died in the defense of this nation. Those of you who are either online or here in the sanctuary, if you on the back of your bulletin, it says that Flory Wallace is the liturgist this morning. Well, those who know Flory and who know Nan know that Flory is not the liturgist this morning. Instead, Nan Bailey has stepped in because Flory is playing bells this morning, and it just was going to be a little much to run back and forth between the bell pit and up here. So, Flory, thank you for playing bells this morning, and Nan, thank you for stepping in on Flory's behalf. Let us now continue in our worship as we attend to the ministry of the Word. Let me invite the children of the congregation go to the children's area for children's church. And I am not quite sure who is taking them this morning, but somebody, I'm sure, will appear.
Let us pray for the illumination of the Spirit. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The first lesson this morning is from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Luke describes the ascension of Jesus. Listen for the word of God. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up into heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle lesson this morning is from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 1, reading verses 15 through 23. Paul speaks of the power God has now given Christ, who sits at his right hand. Listen again for the word of God. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that, with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints? And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of this great power? God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
The gospel reading this morning comes to us from the gospel according to Luke, reading the final verses of the gospel, chapter 24, verses 44 through 53. Once again, just as with the very beginning of Acts, this is the story of Jesus' final words with his disciples and his ascension into heaven. Listen again for the word of God. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continually in the temple, blessing God. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Your word, O Lord, is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Open our eyes now that we may see clearly the path that you've laid out for us. Open our ears that we may hear your word to us this day as you call us to follow you on that path. Open our hearts that with joy and expectation we may follow wherever you lead us. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be fully acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So today, on the final Sunday of Easter season, we celebrate something called the Ascension of the Lord. The day of the Ascension Day was actually a couple of days ago in the liturgical calendar, but since we Presbyterians don't typically worship together day in and day out, we celebrate these kinds of things on whatever Sunday is closest to it, and this is it. And I happen to think that the Ascension of the Lord is one of the most important holidays, one of the most important days in the entire liturgical calendar. Because much like what we celebrate with Christ the King Sunday, it is a reminder to us that the Lord reigns, the Lord rules. Indeed, we say in the Apostles' Creed, "He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead." So hallelujah, Christ reigns in heaven for all of us. Let's go have lunch and go home, shall we? But you know there's more to it than that. Because we live in a world where it looks anything but like Christ reigns. We live in a world that is filled with anger, which I think is perhaps the single most telling characteristic of our age today. It is an age filled with chaos, and you know I've described it 1,000 times. All of the ways we manage to pit ourselves one against another. And that is how our age looks and feels. So how dare I stand in a pulpit and proclaim to you and to all who listen that Christ indeed rules over all. There is a poem, a little over 200 years old now, written by an English poet named Percy Shelley. And it's called Ozymandias, and many of you may know the poem, but I reread it and was struck by how relevant it is even today, and how relevant it is for this day. He writes, "I met a traveler from an ancient land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them on the stand hath sunk a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. And on the pedestal these words appear: My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. Every age has its Ozymandias. Ozymandias was the Greek name for Ramses II, the one whom tradition says was the Pharaoh when the Hebrew people were freed from their captivity in Egypt. It is a reminder that powers come and powers go, and those who are in power think that they stand above all other human beings and that all should be afraid of them and all should revere them. And yet all of them alike go down to the dust. All of them alike are made foolish in the end. And yet standing still is the Christ who rules in heaven. Christ rules not through political power. Christ rules not by the power of armies. Christ does not need an army to defend him. Christ rules by the power of those who believe in him and live within his kingdom, even as they live in countries and cities far and wide. You and I are citizens of that kingdom, even as we are citizens of Tyler, of Texas, of the United States, and indeed of the human race. We stand with legs in both places. And yes, while we obey the rules and the laws of the realms in which we live, we also live in this kingdom. And even though its presence is not obvious to the world around us, we live it nevertheless. And it is by our living in that kingdom, by living its ways, by living its mores, its rules, that we proclaim and we establish through Jesus Christ that reign here on earth. Like I say, we don't do it by imposing it through political power, and we certainly don't do it by imposing it by military power. We do it by moral power, by moral suasion. We who are the subjects of Jesus Christ, the living ones, the ones who dwell in this kingdom, don't have to prove that Jesus is correct. We don't have to prove that we're correct. All that we are called to do is live as though that kingdom were present in all of the world. And a funny thing begins to happen when we live like that. That kingdom begins to appear in little tiny ways. It begins in a room like this. It begins in classrooms up and down these hallways. It begins in churches all over the country and all over the world, where disciples of Jesus Christ gather and practice the redeeming power of love. Love does not rule by political power or by military power. It rules, it reigns by the power that it has to make people sit up and say, something is going on with those people. And whatever it is that's going on with those people, I want it. I want a part of that. Jesus Christ reigns over all. His reign is not obvious to any but those who trust in him. That is you and that is me. But we can make the power of that kingdom become real as we live into that kingdom, as we live in it, and as we live it in the world around us, and as it becomes obvious that somehow and for some reason we live by a different code, not putting others down, not excluding, not ruling by anger, but by the power of love. That's the power that we celebrate today. To this great God who rules in heaven and judges the quick and the dead, to him be all glory, majesty, dominion, and power, now and forever. Amen.
Let us say now what we believe, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let us stand together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Lift up your hearts. Give to the Lord glory and praise. Let us pray for the church and for the world. God, our Father, we pray that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Risen Lord, Jesus, beloved Son of God, share your mercy and grace among all your people. Guide the people of this land and of all nations in the ways of justice, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Risen Lord, Holy Spirit, fill our hearts with the fire and energy to share the word among all people. Risen Lord, God, we do not yet comprehend your mystery, but we strive to. Help open our minds and hearts to see beyond the constraints of this world and our human understanding. Risen Lord, we give thanks today, O Lord, for the men and women of this country who, through the generations, have defended us and fought for your ideals of peace, justice, and the dignity of mankind. Fill the leaders of all lands with courage to strive for peace and understanding, and let them never forget the suffering caused by the wars and conflicts of the past and of this day. We ask your blessing on the souls of those who lost their lives in our armed forces here and in foreign lands, and your comfort for their families and loved ones. Risen Lord, we ask your blessing also on those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. We pray especially for those known to us, whom we will mention shortly, and also to those known only to you, who are in need of your loving care. And now, Lord, hear us as we pray for Don, Bob, Bobby, Margaret, Joey, Tom, Rob, Betty, Todd, David, Chris, Charlotte, David, Kyle, Patty, and our brothers and sisters in Buffalo, New York, and in Uvalde, Texas. We offer these prayers humbly as you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Let us bring to God our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Blessed are you, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Friends, go forth from this place refreshed, restored, renewed. Go forth from this place confident that the Lord indeed reigns. Live into that kingdom. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.